One of the reasons that, I know what I was going to say now, 1960 was the last time both conventions were done in July, and so we have a longer election process, and I've been getting asked, Pastor, which side are you on? Which side should we be? I want to just tell everybody right now, I'm not telling you. And there's two reasons for it. Number one, and I know it's debatable, but number one is there's this little IRS thing about pastors using their position to influence people, and then they'll take away the church's nonprofit status. And it's been argued whether or not that's constitutional or not. I happen to think it's unconstitutional. I don't have a problem telling you that, but I'm not going to tell you how I'm voting. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for. I probably won't even debate the issues too much with you, because I've seen politics ruin friendships, and I'm just not interested in losing friendships. I'm going to be careful in my presentation as much as possible to not even mention candidates' names, although you will recognize when I'm talking about a candidate or the other one. There's just not much I can do about that. But I'm just going to try not to say names for the simple reason that I don't want to give one candidate or the other pulpit time when we're supposed to be talking about Jesus anyway. Okay? And so, now, I personally do love listening to the news, and I listen to the news all the time. I listen to a little bit of sports radio. I listen to political talk radio. I have Sirius XM in the car, so I'm able to listen to NPR and Fox News and CNN wherever I'm at, and those are the three I listen to the most. And then for sports, I factor in Fox Sports and ESPN a little bit, more so even when it's football season. And my daughter hates it, because on Sirius, they always talk about listening in the stream at, you know, ESPNradio.com or FoxNews.com. And so my daughter will say, Daddy, are we having to listen to .com again? She hates .com. But in the news, it's this candidate did this, and then in response, the other candidate retorts and does that, and it's name-calling and mudslinging, the like of which I don't even think we've begun to see. Because what we have are two candidates who really can't run on their record. One doesn't have a political record, and the other is not fond of theirs. And so, even though we're made to believe so. And so what happens? And so, yeah, there's all of this going on. In fact, yesterday I was telling my wife, I was shaking my head, listening to these candidates trip over themselves to explain themselves. And it's just silly. And really, to be honest with you, I think it's kind of sad that this is the direction our nation is going. Now, I don't say that as a political statement. Hear me. I watch politics through the eyes of the great controversy. I watch politics through the eyes of Revelation 13. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is I believe there's going to come a time when the nation will rise up against its people and enforce upon them a system of worship and beliefs. And if he who does not worship the beast and his image, which was set up, will be killed. Isn't that what Revelation 13 tells us? So I watch politics through that lens. Does that make sense? So when I say to you, I think it's sad where we're at, it's not a political statement. It's a statement of reality within the religious community of which I'm a part of and you are as well. You see, I believe that Jesus is coming soon. And I believe that Jesus sets up kings and takes them down. Therefore, in the final outcome of Earth's history, when we look back, we will realize that we had nothing to fear for our future except as we forgot how God led in our past history. I believe that God is not a puppet master pulling strings, but what I do believe is that God works out all things according to for good according to his, I'm getting my words turned around. I believe that God works out all things good to those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. So it doesn't really matter who the president is from a spiritual, eschatological, end time world event perspective. Does that make sense? It just really doesn't. Because what I believe is that Satan is playing the Democrats, and I believe Satan is playing the Republicans. And I believe, and you can look this up in history, that every election cycle, we have watched that pendulum swing further and further to the other side. You think about it. We have a Democrat president. I'm just going to say Democrat because what Democrat actually means has changed, and what Republican means has changed. We have a Democrat president who is further left than any Democratic president before him. Does that make sense? He replaced a Republican president who was further right than any president prior to him. Does that make sense? And he replaced a Democratic president who, to that point, had been further left than anything we'd ever seen. Who replaced two Republican presidents who had been further right than anything we'd ever seen. Who replaced a Democratic president. Do you understand the cycle? And that pendulum just keeps going further and further and further to the point where I said, I vote Jesus for president. You say, why, Pastor Ben? Well, I'll give you several reasons. I like what Woody Allen said. He said, we stand today at a crossroads. One path leads to despair and utter hopelessness. The other leads to total extinction. Let's pray we make the right choice. This is America the beautiful, home of the free and the brave. And George Carlin reminds us that anyone can grow up to be the president. And that's the problem. I know, that's bad. But more than any other year, this seems to be the year of the political joke. Henry Cate said, the problem with political jokes is they get elected. So I said, you know what, in response to that, I want Jesus to be president, not just of the United States. I want him to be president of our planet. I want him to be president of our church. I want him to be president of our community. I want him to be president of my heart. I want God to be first and foremost. What if Jesus were president? What would it look like? How would it be different? This morning, I am not going to finish this sermon with a point. You're going to. We're going to have dialogue in just a few minutes. So if you're looking for the point of the message, I hope you'll find something. We'll finish the thought in 2 weeks when we continue the series. This is going to be one of those ongoing series that just kind of keeps getting in deeper, because as we grow, we want to see what God is doing with us. So what if Jesus were running for president? What would his platform look like? And it got me thinking about two things. First of all, what would Jesus' platform be? I'm going to tackle that more in part two, but it seems to me that the first and most important thing that Jesus told us is that he came to seek and to save the lost, right? So that's number one. The second thing that Jesus tells us in the Great Commission is seeking and saving is going and making disciples and teaching them all things whatsoever as commanded thee. So God's platform would be, number one, I want to save you, and number two, I want you to go make disciples and tell them that they can be saved too. Isn't that pretty simple? But isn't that basically sum up the gospel? You get saved, you go tell others. Isn't that right? Jesus said, you go and tell others what I've done. And so we live in this time and agendas, and you think about agendas, and here's some of the social justice agendas that they're talking about. Poverty, healthcare, civil rights, racism and sexism. We're talking about access to education. We're talking about marriage. Who can get married? We're actually trying to redefine genders today. Do you know that? I mean, we live in a society that is greatly confused. There are people out in our community who want answers, and they don't want doctrines, they want answers. Did you hear me, church? Our doctrines are beautiful things, but a doctrine is meaningless unless it begins to hit at the very facets of life that drive us. Religion is meaningless without context, and doctrines are meaningless without relationships with Christ. Isaiah chapter 59 verse 14 tells us that justice is turned back and righteousness stands afar off. Truth has fallen in the street and equity cannot enter. We live in times that are truly unjust for everyone. Man's heart is filled with the desire for himself. Romans chapter 1, verse 24 tells us that we've exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and we worship and serve the creature rather than the creator. Check this out. I'm going to put this on the screen. It was a statement that was made over 100 years ago. Tell me if it's not true even more so to this day. There are many, not even among educators and statesmen, who comprehend the causes that underlie the present state of society. Those who hold the reins of government are not able to solve the problems of moral corruption, poverty, pauperism. What is pauperism? Pauperism is being poor, but it's the idea that the government is the only thing that can save you. Pauperism pushes people down so that it can take care of them, okay? That's a simplistic way of explaining it. And increasing crime. Do we have increasing crime in our nation today? Oh, yes. And they're trying to tell us that it may not be as strong as we'd like. They're trying to tell us that maybe it's going down. But it does create an issue, okay? So they are struggling in vain, look at this, to place business operations on a more secure basis. If men would give heed to the teaching of God's word, they would be filled with the solution of the problems that perplex them. You see that last statement? That's powerful, isn't it? If we would give heed to the teachings of God's word, and that is for everything, every one of those social justice issues that I mentioned before, I don't have answers for. And I don't in any way intend to demean them, belittle them, make them less. I realize that these are real things that people are dealing with today. The answer is not from a man. The answer is from God's word. Somebody say amen. This is the only way we're going to fix society. But look what it says. They are struggling in vain to place business operations on a more secure basis. One of the number one things that we talk about all the time in political talk, especially in this campaign, is the economy. 1% growth over the last 7 years for our economy. 1%. In the economic world, negligible. It's within the margin of error. In other words, there may be some things that we overlooked, and it could actually be a 1% loss. It's not really true growth. It's not something to get excited about. Striking, isn't it, that at the head of today's political concerns, the trustworthiness of the candidates, lying. This is what our society is dealing with: moral corruption. It's at the top, and it's all through our streets. What would the issues of our nation look like if Jesus were president? What would things look like? Now, someone out there may be saying, but Jesus didn't come to be a social reformer. He came to save us. Well, I might have to disagree with you. I like how Oswald Chambers says it in My Utmost Devotional Bible, page 92. He says, men are saying that Jesus Christ came as a social reformer. Nonsense. We are the social reformers. Jesus came to alter us, and we try to shirk our responsibility by putting our work on him. Jesus alters us, puts us right, and then these principles of his instantaneously make us social reformers. They begin to work straightway where we live. If they don't, it means we haven't been converted yet. When God comes into our lives, when we invite God into our lives, there has to be a change in our. By the way, the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 12 that we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, and Paul tells us elsewhere that we are to be changed. That when we're in Christ, we're a new creature. The Bible says. It's interesting that the word that they use there is metamorphosis. Do you know what metamorphosis means? Metamorphosis is the word that they use to describe what happens to a caterpillar before it becomes a butterfly. If you didn't know that butterfly was a caterpillar beforehand, the change was so stark and so strong and so complete that unless you knew what it was to begin with, you wouldn't know what it was after the fact. You understand what I'm saying? When God changes us, he changes us from the inside out so that except that somebody knew you from before, they say, man, that's a new person there. We are new creatures in Christ. And so when we become new creatures in Christ, the people around us can't help but notice. They can't help but see what's different. They say, oh my goodness, have you noticed? He's a different person. Is that right? Okay. Wow, you guys are a tough crowd today. Maybe it's the preacher. Okay. What does it mean? President, what would it look like if Jesus was president? And then I started thinking about this a little bit more. My title today is The President and the First Lady. And I started thinking about this a little bit more. And it's very important to the American public that we have a First Lady. And we have a fairly popular First Lady right now, Michelle Obama. In fact, I did some research and I said, I wonder, who are the most popular First Ladies of all time? And you know who the most popular First Lady in American history is? I didn't hear it. Eleanor, that's it. Eleanor Roosevelt, most popular first lady in American history. That's right. And this was according to Reuters and the Daily Mail Reporter. They did this survey of American people. The second most popular was Abigail Adams. She was the second president's wife. And Abigail Adams, you know why she was so loved by the American people? It was just a small American country back then. She was loved for her wisdom. John Adams went to her for counsel very often, and she would write extensively to others, and she raised children, one of which would be later become a president. So she's very loved. The third most was Jacqueline Kennedy. You ever heard of her? You know why she was liked? Because she was unprecedented in style and class. Yeah. The fourth is Dolly Madison, because she saved George Washington's picture when the White House was burning in 1812. That's not the only reason. Dolly Madison was quite the hostess. And then the fifth most popular of all time is Michelle Obama. Did you know that? It's pretty interesting. And number six is one of the candidates for president. Just thought I'd throw that out there. The least influential was a lady you may not have ever heard about. Her name was Jane Pierce. Her husband was a one-termer, and leading up to the days of the Civil War, Franklin Pierce was the 14th president. Jane Pierce hardly had any presence there in the White House. Now, everything pertaining to the first lady of the country is unofficial. She technically doesn't have to do anything she doesn't want to do, but traditionally, she does two things. Traditionally, these two things are to be a hostess and an organizer for socials and ceremonies at the White House, and they pick a cause to promote that hopefully isn't divisive for their husband's campaign. Okay? And so you think about that. Michelle Obama has been speaking out against childhood obesity, and Laura Bush was for nationwide literacy and better education. It was Nancy Reagan who actually started the Just Say No campaign against drugs. And so you have these first ladies that had their causes that they were involved with. And so I was thinking about this. If Jesus is going to be our president, who would be his first lady? And then I remembered that the Bible likens the church to a bride prepared for the bridegroom, and the Bible tells us that Christ is the bridegroom, so therefore the church is the first lady. Oh, don't say amen yet. You don't know what that means. The first lady of the United States does not live in a house that is contained. She lives in a clear house, a transparent house. I know you were going to say the White House, but no, you get to see transparently what goes on. The American people clamor to know what's going on. I don't know why, but we love living vicariously through the lifestyles of the rich and famous. Maybe it's because we're not so rich and famous. I don't know. But the Bible, many times, in fact, more than a dozen times, relates the church to being the bride of Christ. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 to 27, talks about husbands loving your wives as Christ loves the church. And Isaiah 54 tells us that our maker is our husband, the Lord of hosts is his name. And Matthew 25 is the story of the 10 virgins who were waiting for the bridegroom to come. Revelation 19 verse 7 to 9 tells us to be glad and rejoice and give God glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, his wife has made herself ready. You see, the idea is that the church is God's first lady. So then I started thinking, if the church is the bride of Christ, then that means that the church is the first lady if Jesus is president, which made my mind swirl with ideas and possibilities, and I started comparing first ladies of the United States with the idea of the church being the first lady. And here's where I went with this. You know, the first lady can cause a president to be more or less popular just by her words. Did you know that? Much of the popularity of President Obama is not because of his policies, but because of his wife. You don't have to like the president not to like Mrs. Obama. She's a classy lady. She has her agenda, and you know, you see her in the news and you say, okay, now some of you may be sitting there going, oh, I could tell you about, that's not my point this morning, okay? I'm just telling you that this is a lady that the majority of the American public likes. In fact, I would argue that of modern first ladies, she's the most popular because all the ones ahead of her died a long time ago. They were from previous generations. And maybe that's part of the issue, so I started looking at this and I said, well, now think about this. The first lady has to choose carefully what she says. Her public life is almost as scripted as the president's life. She'll get criticized if she's not in public enough. She gets criticized if she goes on vacation too much. She gets criticized if she's not at the state dinner. She's criticized if she's too critical. Her words, her actions, and her beliefs have a direct impact on the president and his effectiveness. I'm going to say that again. The first lady has a direct impact on the president's effectiveness by her words, her actions, and her beliefs. If the church is the first lady of Christ, then we have a direct impact on his effectiveness with the people around us based on our words, our beliefs, and our actions. Oh, y'all didn't like that. It was silent in here. Think about that. Which made me immediately make the comparison. How many people today would vote for Jesus for president based on what they see in our church? What do people see when they see our attitudes, our actions, or our behaviors? What do people see and think when they hear us talking? Because you see, everything that we do is a testimony. It's a witness to what we believe and what we think. So I have to slow down sometimes too, because my passion is for God, and because part of my passion is the church, then I want to do things in the church. And sometimes I get so carried away in my activity for the church that I realize that I'm railroading people. Sometimes we put policy before we put people, don't we? Sometimes we put our doctrines before people. Y'all aren't hearing me now. We don't do this because it'll break the commandments. We don't do that because it goes against our doctrinal beliefs. We don't put certain things on the platform because it goes against our culture. Y'all aren't hearing me this morning. We put our own personal values in ahead of what really matters. And at the end of the day, what really matters? People. If there are no people in this building, there's no reason to have this building. And I want to tell you something, church. Millennials don't care about 28 fundamental beliefs. And many Gen Xers, I'm a Generation Xer, many Gen Xers don't care about 28 fundamental beliefs. You know what they care about? They care about if you are representing the Jesus that you are trying to present to them. That's what they care about. They don't care about talking about feeding the poor. They want to know if you're feeding the poor. They don't care about what kind of clothes you're wearing. They care about what kind of clothes you're providing to those that don't have any. People today are less interested in doctrines and more interested in relationships. And so if we're failing at our relationships, it really doesn't matter because there's not going to be very many people left anyway. I have to slow down sometimes and realize that as part of the first lady of Christ. Oh, that just sounds weird, doesn't it? Maybe I just answered why he's taken so long. If I'm a part of the bride of Christ and he's imagining me in a wedding gown, I wouldn't come back either. Okay, I digressed. I wanted to see if I could draw you back in. Come on, work with me here this morning. We're a part of the body of the bride of Christ. We're the first lady, and we're all a part of that. And so I started thinking about this, and I started wrestling with this. And this last week, two weeks ago, my children and I had an experience down the road here at the Taco Bell, just right down the road here. It was right an hour before VBS was about to begin, and the kids were hungry, so I ran them down, and we went inside, and we ordered what we ordered. We almost always order the same things. And so we went in, and we're ordering, and I got to talking with the manager. Now, I believe in forging relationships with people in the community, and if it's going to be somebody that I'm going to be, Taco Bell is not my favorite restaurant in the world, but I find myself there a lot. Mostly because it's cheaper, and mostly because it's quick and it's easy, and I forgot, see, I got a table up here, now I can put my water up here. And so I was talking to the manager, and I told her, I said, I'm new in the community. I'm the new pastor down at the South Tacoma Adventist Fellowship. Told her who I was and told her what I do. And she and I connected just like that. And so she and I are on a first name basis. And she introduced me to all the rest of her staff. And so I got acquainted with them. And then my kids, you know, Sienna is little and she's really cute. And Dominic is big and getting way too big way too fast, but he's handsome. And so she said, can I give your kids some cinnamon twists? I said, sure. So she gave the kids some cinnamon twists. And then, before we're leaving, the assistant manager came out and gave us two more bags of cinnamon twists for the road. And I was like, hey. And my kids were like, hey, I like this place. You know, yeah. Daddy, can we go back tomorrow? No, really. Too much Taco Bell is a good thing, you know. All right. So, that was on Monday. And then on Thursday of the week of VBS, the kids were hungry. And so I said, okay. We were bringing sack lunches, but by the time, you know, all day your food's sitting in a bag. So we went to supper and kids wanted to go back to Taco Bell. And she remembered us. And this time my wife was with me. And so the four of us are sitting at the table. And listen, Taco Bell is walk up to the counter, make your order, give them the money. They bring your food to the counter and you go sit down and you eat, right? Not if you're an Orian at that Taco Bell. It was cool. We made our order. We went and sat down. And as we're eating, they came to our table and they said, would you all like anything else? And of course, my kids have hollow legs. I mean, they will eat us out of house and home. My son spent the summer with my grandparents, and my grandparents loved having them, but they're glad they're not feeding him anymore. I'm kidding, buddy. He was looking sad. They have hollow legs. And so the guy at the register, he came over to our table and he said, can I get you guys anything? And the kids said, yeah. And they made their order. And he went over there, he rang it up at the register, and then he went back and made it, and then he brought it out to the table. And I was like, wow, that never happens. And as we're leaving, they gave the kids their drinks. I mean, just gave the kids their drink. And we're just like, wow, this is really nice. And so last week, the kids and I were in there again. And she said, hey, Ben, how you doing? And the kids were like, Dad, she remembered you. And I was like, I know, it's kind of cool. And they were all excited because they got a drink. And did you get a cinnamon twist that time, Dominic? I don't remember. I don't think they did. Maybe they did. I don't remember. Anyway, my point in telling you all of that is that every time I drive by that Taco Bell now, I have kids in the back seat who go, Daddy, can we go there again? Why? Because they had a tremendous experience there. Because somebody went out of their way to make them feel special and important and to do something extraordinary for them. As simple as it was with a bean burrito. My point to you this morning is, we're not dealing with bean burritos and tacos. We're dealing with the very bread of life. We're dealing with the Word of God. We're dealing with Jesus Himself. This experience should be so spectacular, so extraordinary, that people are tripping over themselves waiting to get back for the next experience with God. What if we could get people that excited about coming to church that every time they drove by our church, they said, oh man, I just want to swing in there. It's not that I had any money today and I'm not really all that hungry, but I just want to go in and experience it one more time. Are you with me? How do we do that? It's not by preaching 28 fundamental beliefs. It's by meeting needs. Now listen to me. Let me qualify something real quickly. I'm not telling you that the 28 fundamental beliefs aren't meaningful. They do. They matter. And I think that they are important. They define who we are and they are what separate us from the rest of the world. Are you hearing me, church? And Jesus, the Bible tells us in Revelation, we need to remember that the Bible calls us out of false systems of worship. So I'm not telling you that we should stop believing those things. What I'm telling you is that we don't win people to Jesus with those things. That's called discipleship. It comes after they've met Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? What if Jesus were president? We need to understand that the church is God's. And the church is Christ's bride. And as broken as she is, as problematic as she can be, and as imperfect as she is, Christ still loves her so much that he gave his only begotten Son for her, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Until we can love with that kind of love, we will never become what God wants us to become. until we love people the way God loves people, until we see people the way God sees them, without reference to gender, without reference to ethnicity, without reference to culture or skin color. Are you hearing me, brothers and sisters? Racism has no place in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Everyone is loved and accepted by God, therefore we should love and accept everyone by God as well. People before policy. God wants us to sacrifice for others the way He sacrificed for us. He wants us to treat other people the way He treats us. Others before my beliefs, others before my opinions, others before my agendas, others before me. So what would it look like if Jesus were president? Now, I've given you a whole lot of things to ponder and think about. Now it's time to have a dialogue about it. And as I set that up, I was thinking about past presidents. And it was George Washington who said, "It is impossible to righteously govern the world without God and the Bible." He's right, isn't he? It was Ronald Reagan who said, "Within the covers of one single book, the Bible, are all the answers to all the problems that face us today, if only we would take time to read," and then he said, "believe." What if Jesus were president today? What if we could win people over like that? What would it look like if we could put this behind us and truly let God be our solution and our answers? If you have your mobile device, I want to take a few minutes now, and I want to have a digital discussion with you. And I realize not everybody can do this, and I'm sorry, but more and more people have mobile devices and are able to text message. All you have to be able to do is text message to be able to participate in this next part. And if you can't, I'm going to figure out a way to get everybody involved. But also, if you're watching in the stream, I'm going to put it up on the screen here in a minute. So I want you all at home to participate as well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a question on the screen. And as you respond, you'll be able to see the responses live right here on the screen. So we'll all be able to interact together. For the most part, this is supposed to be anonymous. And I'm still learning how this system works. This is kind of a new thing for me to engage in a dialogue while I'm preaching. In fact, while I've been preaching, I've gotten a couple of text messages, which is kind of cool. And I look forward to being able to have this kind of discussion with you as we go and see what that looks like. But here's how this works. It's supposed to show up automatically. What happened? Uh-oh. Give me just a second. There it comes. Okay. It's coming. It's just taking a second because of the internet. And it's kind of small on the screen. What happened there? The way this works is, here we go. The way this works is, I've set up a staff conversation for us. And so, on your text messaging, you go to your text messenger, and where it says who you want to send it to, if you were going to send me a text, you would put my phone number in there. What you want to do is you want to type in 22333. That's who you're going to text to, okay? So if you were texting to me, you would text my phone number. You would go into your contacts, and you'd say, "Text Pastor Ben." Here you're going to go to 22333. And then I want you to text the word staff. The message is the word staff. That way you can join this conversation. Okay? I've already done it, so I'm already a part of the conversation. But in your text messages, you go to a clean message screen. You create a new one. It says new message. And right there you type 22333. And then in the message, type staff. Once you've done that, here's the question. If you were on a committee to impact change in our community, the Tacoma community, which of these is most concerning to you? These are the five social justice issues that we talked about earlier in the message. So if your answer is poverty, you're going to text the letter A. You're going to put the letter A in your message and text 2223 is the person you're texting it to, and you'll be able to see it up there. So I'm going to text my response. Oh, somebody's already texting there. That wasn't me, but that's somebody else. Good. Look at them coming in there. Good. Got some answers. There they come. Now they're coming in. See that? What's most important to you? Text your answers in there. Look at that. Look at them move. Give a few more seconds here for the conversation to continue. Isn't that interesting? A few more seconds. Got to get back on this side here. Oh, still coming in. Good. I'll give one or two more seconds. Anybody having a problem? Let me tell you how to do it one more time. Dominic, yours working? It's not working? Okay. Another thing that you can do is go to www. If you're working on a mobile device that doesn't do text messaging, you can go to pollev.com/staff on your web device, and you should be able to do it from there as well. Okay, still a few more answers coming in. All right, let's talk about this for a minute. I wish I knew what percentage of our audience answered here. But of those who did answer, we see, oh, it's still going, good. First of all, I think this is kind of cool. Anybody with me? All right, and listen, as we go along through this series, I'm going to try to be more and more meaningful in this. Part of this is just to get a feel for it and make sure it's going to work. But I hope to have more meaning as we go and more meaningful questions. So, of those who are responding, what I'm seeing is that 41% of those who are responding say that dealing with poverty is the number one thing that they would be concerned with here in our congregation. Would it be a safe assumption to say that if everybody had access, that that would still be the largest response? So maybe as a church, what we need to start thinking about is how we would address poverty right here in our backyard. The zip code 98444, which is where our church is at, is one of the most depressed counties or zip codes in the state of Washington. Did you know that? It's not the most, it's among the most. Did you know that? That means there's a lot of work. Okay, good. Ready for another one? Let's try another one, shall we? The rules are all the same. You're still going to, if you have your screen open, you should be able to text. Here's the next question. What do you think our community needs most? I kind of suspected that poverty might be the number one answer. But so you're going to text here letter A for food and shelter, B for counseling or advocacy, C for safe social activities, in other words, helping to get youth off the street. Family preservation is another important one. The breakup of the family is such a huge deal. Text your responses there. I want to make sure I get my response in. Okay, how's the answers going? Somebody responded. Oh, somebody's texting me their answers. Okay. I'll put your answer in, okay? Because it's not counting that it came from me. So since I'm overseeing it, I'm going to put that answer that somebody just texted me and put it in there for you. There it is. Now you got representation. I didn't see it move. Okay? Any more? Any more? Still a few more trying out there? If you're online, go ahead and do it too. Again, I wish I knew how many people were actually active. I'll know later. It'll send me the statistics later, and I might share those with you later. Okay, so look here. We have food and shelter. Oh, they're moving on me. Food and shelter is number one. And right behind that is family preservation, followed closely by safe social activities. Okay. Oh, they're moving some more. Look at that. Family preservation just caught up with food and shelter. Anybody else out there? I'll wait one more moment, and then I'll go on to the last question. The last question is going to be real interesting. I don't know how this last one's going to work. Okay, here's what I'm seeing right now. I'm seeing that our church is interested, by and large, in reducing poverty in our community. And it's still moving up there, but we have an interest in preserving the family and providing food and shelter to our community in needs. Okay, are you reading that the same way I am? All right, so that's going to bring me to the next question. Okay, food and shelter moved ahead now. Any more? Last call? Ready for the last one? Okay, this is still moving on me. Now this last one, you're going to actually get to openly text your responses, and hopefully this will do it right, and I'll be able to put your responses up on the screen once I've proofread them. I may have done it wrong. We'll see. Here's the question. In the next week, What are some things that you could do to begin meeting those needs that we've talked about? Okay, so we've talked about poverty, and we've talked about family preservation, and we've talked about food and shelter. In this coming week, what are some things that you could do to be a part of helping to begin to meet these needs? It's not that you're going to go out and start meeting the actual need. What can we do to begin preparing? If we're as a church going to start doing something, then it's about time that I quit preaching. It's about time that we start doing something together, right? So what are we going to do? I just thought I'd throw that out there to see what you thought. Anybody got some responses? I don't see any coming up on my screen yet. They're sending them. Okay. So, where are they at is the question. I will find them. Just a second. I will find them. There's five responses there so far. Where are they? Why can't I see them? Okay, bear with me 1 second. 10 responses. Look at this. Okay, let's see if I can get the answers this way. Nope. That's not it. Sorry, that's a different poll from... I was trying to hook this up. Okay, here we go. Here are the responses. I'm not sure how I'm going to get this up on the screen so that you can see this. But here's some answers that I've got here. Ask someone to come to church with them. Pray for guidance. Share food from the garden with neighbors. That's cool. Visit the homeless shelters. Each out to community programs that already exist. In other words, I'm assuming that that means use community programs for our church or the community that already exist and use them to reach people. Here's another one. Bring groceries to a family or to a shelter or volunteer at that shelter. That's good. I like this one. Come up with more ideas. It really says that. Here's one. I bet I can guess who said this one. Donate socks. Where's Britt? Not to call anybody out. It may not have been him. I like this one. Pray. Are there any other answers? Are there any other answers? I refresh that. I'm sorry. That's supposed to pop up on the screen so that you can see that. And I don't know why it's not bringing up our answers. Any other responses? I haven't opened the poll yet, huh? Interesting. Okay. There we go. Are they coming now? Look at that. All right. Let's see if I can get that back up on the big screen now. Let's see. Will this work? Okay. There they are. If you text now, it should pop up there. There they come. Donate socks. See, I told you I didn't make that one up. Look at that one. Support SDA Community Services. So those are some good answers. Each one, go out to the community, programs that already exist. Yeah, visit homeless shelters. There's all the ones that I read. If there's any more, they'll pop up there. What do you think, church? Are we barking up the wrong tree? Am I wasting our time this morning by talking about making a difference? Because I want to tell you something. What we do is what defines our Christianity. And everything that I have done in the 3 weeks, 4 weeks of our last series and setting up for the future is for nothing. Look at this. I think that we should have counseling here in the church for families so that we can have family preservation. Be more compassionate with others so we can represent Jesus' character. Pray for others. Gym nights for community youth. Save money to feed the hungry. Make church fun. Oh, I'm trying to do that. Is this not fun? Set up a fund to buy clothing for the homeless. Collect clothes for the homeless since cold season is coming upon us soon. Donate clothes and food. Every one of these ideas up here so far are things that we can do. And every one of these things up here are things that will make a difference. Seriously, I thought I was trying to make church fun. Basketball nights, educate, give resources on how to help individuals help themselves for the long term, not just one day. Yeah. These are really good ideas. You see, church, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is what defines our Christianity. And if we're truly going to grow as a church, not just numerically as far as how many people are in here on Sabbath morning, if we're going to grow as individuals in the faith, then we've got to start doing what Jesus did and start loving people the way Jesus loved them. And these are really great ideas. They're still coming in. Check it out. Serve a meal once a week to the homeless and the needy. I like it. Feed the homeless. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, Larry. I can't make that larger right now, but I'm going to work on it this week and see if I can make it larger for next week. It's still popping up. Give food, dollar tracts with cardboard signs to help. Church, pass out free water to people and offer to pray if they want to talk about the Bible or answer any questions they may have in regards to Christianity. Let's go sing at the nursing home, somebody said. It's pretty good. I'm going to find a way to make that bigger so everybody can see that. I'm sorry, that's a little bit small. These are good ideas. Keep them coming in. I'll print them off later. What I want to do now is I want to offer a word of prayer and sing and we'll leave, because it went longer than I thought it would. But we're going to fix this and figure this out. And we're going to grow together, not only as a church in faith, but we're going to grow in our acts of loving kindness for the people that need Jesus desperately. Are you with me on this? A couple of weeks ago, I asked, are you all in? Are you still all in? Because that's what it's going to take. Let me pray, and then we'll sing our song. Father in heaven, this is, to me, it's exciting to see these ideas. What if we could take these ideas and do something with them, God? What if you blessed as we started doing these ideas and we truly started reaching the community to make a difference? Because at the end of the day, if Jesus were our president, that's what he would be asking us to do. The apostles admonished each other to feed the widows and the orphans and to care for them. It's not just widows and orphans today. There's a lot of hurting and broken people in our society. And what is our church good for if we don't strive to love these people as Jesus loved them? Our resources may be limited, but yours aren't. So as you bless us, Father, may we in turn bless others. And as we bless others more, bless your church more so that we can do more until the day when Jesus comes. And he is inaugurated not as president of the world, but as king of the universe. We long for that day. May it be soon. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.